Nice to see you, by the way.
I know, it's a long day.
You're kind of one of the community groups of filmmakers, it seems like, in the that are out right now. There's some in Austin, there's a couple in New York, Seattle. Is that how you guys are still operating and feeling?
Sure, I think having a group to do this kind of work is kind of essential. And I think our friends Sean Durkin and Josh Mann and Antonio Campos are sort of a group in New York, and mm-hmm. we're sort of holding down the fort here in LA. But there, you know, but there's also just the whole group of us young filmmakers. There's Drake Doremus, who made Like Crazy, and Mariam mm-hmm. Keshavez, who made what's Mariam's movie called?
I don't know, but I love Mariam's movie.
This is
untitled Mariam Keshavez.
No. Circumstance. Yeah. Circumstance. Yeah.
So are you, so like Drake, for instance, is he just somebody you now know because you guys have been on this circuit together, been to festivals and all that, or?
No, Drake and I went to film school together. Not at the same time. He was ahead of me at film school.
Huh.
And then when we were going to make Sound of My Voice, he had just shot Like Crazy. Mm-hmm. And so, went out to dinner with him, and I was telling him we were thinking of shooting on the red camera, and he was like, no, shoot on the 7D. I just shot it. You can get two cameras out of it. Hmm. And we couldn't afford the red anyway, so that was great advice.
So do you all have, in your particular group, in your tighter group, do you all have different roles that you know you want to play, or is Britt going to end up directing two films from now, or?
Britt is never going to end up directing. I don't have the talent skill set for that. Directing is really hard, and I don't know, Zal and Mike do it so effortlessly. I think you have to, as a director, be somebody who feels things very deeply, has a very unique point of view, and then the ability to articulate all that. I mean, having all three of those things and then like three cherries in a row on the slot machine is very rare. And Zal has that in spades. So I like to surrender to that. And I just do my work as an actor, which is a very micro part of the story.
But you're a co-writer on this film as well.
Yeah, I mean, we write together, and that's a beautiful collaborative phase. And it's fun because we all know each other so well. We come to the writing part with all the stories that we're just living in our lives, and we talk and we share. And then eventually, in the center of that hurricane, some eye comes that is like the story that is for right now. And then we spend some time writing it together. But once we're finished, it's actually a great part to, we really like draw a line in the sand, and like Zal goes away and directs, and I go away and act. And when I show up on set, I'm just one of the many actors that he is, you know, that he's dealing with. And so it's actually nice that how close we get in the writing, and then the way that we have to separate to do that work and then come together again and in, you know, editing. It's a really, it's a beautiful process.
But the transitions are always hard. Like, you know, transitions are hard on humans. So transitioning from writing to then just the prep of getting the movie made, you know, mm-hmm. just trying to push that boulder up the hill. We do that together too. And then once the boulder is gone over that hill, and as it comes down into starting the actual prep of the movie, we go on to our different roads.
Do you have a formal writing process that you guys do, or is it?
It's a lot like this.
We have a very formal writing process. It's like we develop a, and I think it's because in the beginning, it's hard to just convince yourself you could maybe even do this work. And so mm-hmm. you're filled with doubt. You don't know what you're doing. Everyone's telling you to start filling out your application for law school. It's like, and we would set up these like 4-hour chunks in the day where we're like, okay, we're meeting here at this time. You have to turn off your cell phone, you have to shut down your email, mm-hmm. and for these 4 hours, we're going to focus on writing. And that was a really good way to begin, that sort of sense of discipline, because otherwise it's hard to create something out of nothing, you know, thin air. And we spent a lot of time telling the story back and forth, and then eventually we begin outlining. And we don't really start writing until it's ready. You know, until we can tell the story to any stranger at a mm-hmm. coffee shop from beginning to end, and they're like, the whole time, then you know you're ready to open final draft. That takes a while.
So in some ways, the stereotype of Hollywood of, you know, do a pitch in 25 seconds or less of your movie rings true even in this kind of film for you guys. You want it to be like very clear and sharp.
Yeah, I think it's very true. I think that you want it to be like a bullet or like a dart, you know, that you shoot from your bow and arrow, and it hits people, and it hits them hard enough that they're like, we're going to write a check for you to make this movie, or we're going to, you know, pick up the phone and call our actor and tell them to be in the movie. Mm-hmm. I mean, it has to do that. And it has to do that so many times. It has to do that every time, you know, we're telling the story to each other, but then when we start telling people who might want to produce the movie, and then to the cinematographer, and then the actors and their people, and then, you know, when you're shooting the movie, you have to sort of keep the morale up all the time. This is what we're making. Because you get so in the forest, it's hard to see the forest. You're just tree, tree, tree. And so you have to keep telling yourself, oh, I'm making a movie about this, or this is why we're making this movie. And then you end up here, if you're lucky, talking to you. And you have to be able to say the movie pretty quickly, and someone at home has to then say, hey, I might look that movie up and I might go see that in a theater.
That's so many arrows hitting people in the heart over and over again. It's hard.
Well, they say every movie's a miracle. You know, even a studio movie, it's the fact they actually get made is kind of stunning. Good is a whole nother level.
Yeah.
Amazing.
True.
So that first pierce has to be pretty strong. And, you know, a lot of people will tell their movie idea and I sort of like gloss over, and I think, am I like a very Hollywood person that I'm glossing over? But I think no. I think you want to hear an idea that makes you lean in when someone's giving you an idea.
So this is a much more formalistic movie in terms of that than, say, Another Earth. Another Earth is a harder to describe picture overall. Is that just who Mike is and who you are? Is that the reality of the situation?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting to compare. I was talking about Antonio and Josh and Sean earlier. They really pool in together and they really support each other as they make. I'm sure they give each other a lot of script notes and then are on set. They produce each other's movies when the other friend's not. We're not like that at all. We do that for each other in real life, but the work is really separate. You know, I feel like Brit's so good about being a vault that she doesn't tell me what's going on with Mike, and she doesn't tell Mike what's going on with our project. And then that initial moment where, you know, we finished Sound of My Voice and we gave it to Mike, or I remember with The East, when we finished that and you give it to Mike, and Mike's the only person you really care about his reaction. So you want that reaction to be fresh, but then he reads it, has his reaction, and then we go try to make that movie, and then we want to show him the final project. But he's not involved in each step.
So is this how you keep your sanity, Britt, is by keeping the wall up between each of your roles in this family?
I think so. I mean, I think also, like, I think it makes everyone actually able to be more helpful to one another. The truth is that when Zal and I have given drafts of The East to Mike, he's the first person we give it to. His notes matter the most. Like, and because he hasn't been involved at every stage of the writing, the draft can actually have real impact on him. Like, he's getting it fully formed and like—
Or not have real impact on him.
Or not, and then you're like, better go back to the drawing board. You know, like, so that, If we had been pitching him the story at every step of its sort of embryonic development, there's no way he can actually be as useful, and vice versa. You know, I think that that's how we managed to help each other best, actually.
So was this script, once you knew what you had and you were kind of happy with what the script was, relatively easy to move forward with? I mean, was this
which one?
This Sound of My Voice. Sound of My Voice.
No, not at all. We couldn't get. You know, I'd gone to film school at AFI, which is, you know, a film school down the street, and there was a style of how you make your first feature. You know, AFI has a rich tradition of having writer-directors make their first features, and so I thought I had to make it in that style. You know, we'd written the script. We wanted a small, very modest budget, but we wanted to have a proper crew and all that stuff. And in 2009, you couldn't get, for first-timers, unknown actress, unknown director, untested actor, untested director. We couldn't get money to make Sound of My Voice.
You couldn't get money to do that now. I mean, I wonder if you... But the great thing is you don't really need money, and that's the thing we finally came to, and this sort of liberation of making something and realizing that your smallness, your sort of off-the-gridness, not everything being according to union rules and this and that, like, that's something that actually is an incredible advantage. Like, you can infiltrate places and shoot in spaces that $100 million movies wish they could get small enough to get inside. And you just are doing it effortlessly. So I think the moment that your brain clicks over and you're like, wait, this is actually something that's going to make the movie better, not something that's going to cripple it, it becomes a really free way to make a film, like a liberating way to make a film.
I agree.
So is the feel of this film designed to work that way? I mean, it is a little claustrophobic. It is a lot of small rooms that aren't necessarily on locations or anything. Is that part of the design of how you wrote it, put it together?
Totally. I mean, I think it's even in the way in how we execute it. So we wanted to have really good actors, but no known faces, you know, no recognizable faces. So that was adding to the claustrophobia, because you turn this way, you turn this way, you turn that way, and there's nobody for you to feel safe with. You know, a known face is kind of relaxing.
Comfort.
Yeah.
So do you feel like Brit's a known face now?
Well, maybe.
It's funny how it's changed in the course of a year or two since you made the movie.
I don't think so. known to who? Like, four people in, like, Silver Lake in Brooklyn?
Well, but it's funny how you're the center of the movie in many ways. You're not the lead of the movie, but you are the center of the movie, and you're the person who arrives and needs to have that kind of impression on the viewer of the movie. And before the movie went to Sundance, nobody knew that you existed, practically. You know,
but I knew that she would have that effect still. I mean, I thought that was always the thing that we'd have as a low-budget, ultra-low-budget film, is that I knew that if you scrubbed down and put on plastic cuffs and blindfolded your face and, you know, put on a scrub or, you know, hospital gown, and then you go down the basement stairs and into the basement, and you're sitting in this sort of gross basement with these cream color walls and cream color carpet, and you're sitting there, and a woman comes out with a shroud. I knew that if Brit was under that shroud, the audience would actually lean in, you know, and when we were shooting it and we got to that moment and the camera sort of dollies into her and she lifts up the shroud, sure enough, I leaned into the monitor. And I think we knew that whether she was recognizable or not, she had a certain magic.
I see you rolling your eyes, Brit.
it's a lot of hocus pocus, because it's actually really all about story. Those are just all story beats, like leading you to somebody. And that's all Zal's filmmaking that's like taking you there.
Oh, come on. No, but I mean, let's get real.
You're not feeling magical yet.
No, but let's get real. That you have that. You have a certain quality about you. You have that quality, and we knew that we had that, or I knew as a director that I had that quality in my arsenal of ingredients. And that actually that face being sort of unrecognizable, and I think still to, you know, the lucky audience member that's gonna walk into Sound of My Voice without knowing anything about the film, and maybe hasn't seen Brit before, that they'll be like, who's that? You know, that's an interesting person. I wanna know more about that person. And then to find out that she also wrote the script. It's a good story.
So was the movie you guys now have shot easier, or was it still in the, were you still holding back into the keep it small, keep it quiet section of the career?
No, I mean, I think The East was difficult for a whole host of reasons separate from what made Sound of My Voice difficult. The East is a big film that we shot for not a lot of money, a lot more money than Sound of My Voice, but you know.
The thing is, the moment you start adding the rules, like the AFI rules, of that money actually gets sucked up pretty quickly and doesn't get spent in the most efficient ways, like all the time. And there are moments even on The East where we would, you know, we'd operate as a big movie and then we'd like pare things down and try to, you know, because you have to sort of mix it up in order to get the breadth and scope that you want. But yeah, it was cool. It was awesome to make The East.
Was getting the money easier, or was it before all this happened that you were chasing money?
No, The East, so Fox Searchlight bought Sound of My Voice and they decided they wanted to make The East, so that all happened.
So the timing was good.
That all happened at the same time.
Because I think it's one of the fascinating things about these groups, the Duplasses in some ways in the front, but also at Paramount, we now have the ongoing saga of Drake's movies. Which I guess he's finally finished cutting his other movie.
I hear it's really good.
Well, he's been, every time I see him, he's like, I'm in the cutting room, I'm in the cutting room. But it's this weird thing of kind of growing up very fast, because everybody's kind of waiting for you. You all are kind of like the next generation, and the studios, particularly the indies, really want this to happen, but they also want all the, you know, once they're involved, all of a sudden you have to pay unions, and you have to do all these other things. So it's an interesting balance of trying to keep your sanity, I think, during that transition.
That's really thoughtful of you to say that, because that's true. And we're all in a transition. It's a transitional period for movie making, you know? And the question is, what are we all going to do? Do you stay at this budget, or do you just leap forward? I mean, a part of me thinks that actually we'd be even better suited at a much larger budget, that actually that's really the canvas we've been wanting to work on the whole time, and that we just haven't had those resources. But then I think that some other people love the freedom, the creative freedom that making a smaller film affords them.
Are you as an actor, Britt? Is it, you've now done both, you've been on both kinds of sets. Is it different to you? Is it, you're happy to go back to something smaller when you've done something bigger, or?
You know what's weird about it? I mean, it should be more different than it is. Like, I don't even notice. Does craft surfaces change? Does the lighting apparatus change? Like, what's, I don't know. I think the funny thing as an actor is that I'm just so overwhelmed with the responsibility of, like, what I'm supposed to make real to myself in this story. And that challenge every time is, like, unfathomable, unknowable, like, leap that you're taking. And so I get so lost in that world. Like, the size of the set, you know, when we're making movies and coming at it from a producing perspective, that's all really interesting, and you're trying to problem solve and get creative and figure out how to get more for less, and that's a fun muscle to work for a while. But then the moment you begin, you're coming in as an actor, it's like all that turns off, and you, literally your job is to, like, not see the lights and not lose track of the sound, and, you know, 100 people or 10 people all literally vanish. Like, they just, like, go away. And you're in this world, and it's you and one other person, and you're talking, and you're listening, and you're feeling. And so in that way, you don't notice anything.
So did you have specific visual cues in this movie that you guys were inspired by? Were there definite references to other movies, or?
Yeah, there weren't that many references to other movies, I don't think, at least not consciously. But we were interested in the idea of sort of the mundane taking an ethereal quality. Sort of that basement I was talking about, the cream carpeting and the white walls, and how sort of grossly mundane that is. But what if that becomes sort of a spiritual
experience?
Or playground, yeah, experience. Yeah, that's good.
Well, what Britt actually was saying about the, you know, tuning out the lights and everything else is, I guess, kind of the same experience as being in the basement, ultimately.
Yeah, I mean, I guess this idea of surrender to something bigger than you are. Like, as an actor, you're in your own kind of cult. I mean, every time we make a film, we're in a cult, and we enter a cult together, and there are rules to it, and you go, you wear this, you show up this time, you leave this time, and the higher power for everyone is the story, and we all are just in agreement that the higher power is the story, and we're surrendering to it every day, and we're just doing the best we can to, like, make it happen. It's the same thing as the cult and sound of my voice, you know? There is a higher power, and that higher power is, like, Maggie's knowledge of the future, and everyone's coming in and surrendering to that, and they're both this, you know, desire to believe in, like, something impossible or extraordinary existing in a totally mundane space, like a soundstage, or like the SLS conference, refrigerated conference room, or like,
we're getting you ready for a Letterman spot.
This basement.
The coldest studio in America.
Yeah.
So do you have, I mean, this movie visually is very distinct, and there's definitely a rhythm to it. It reminded me a little bit of All That Jazz in that way, the ritual of the shower and the drugs and everything that he does every morning. But you know, reduce it as you go along. Was that all laid out in the script, or was that a matter of what you did in editing, or?
That's all in the script. Those high-res cuts are in the script, too. We would sort of do them as, you know, hands bind, M-dash, you know?
We got so into the M-dash in this movie. Zal taught me the M-dash.
What is the M-dash?
I love the M-dash. Yeah, my dad taught me the M-dash. There's the N-dash, which is the medium dash. The M-dash is the longer dash. And sort of, I think in a script, like, really cool scripts use the sort of visual space of the page to convey the story. So if you do hands cuffed dash, you know,
you're moving.
Eyes blindfold dash. Your eye is moving down. You're having something,
like,
cinematic
happen.
Yeah, or poetry. Yeah, Britt's a good poet.
Or you're insane. It's one or the other.
In the beginning, when we'd write together, my dashes were all over the place. Like, sometimes they were single, sometimes they were double, sometimes they had double space before them, double space behind. And Zal finally was like, we have to work out this dash thing. Like, you cannot keep doing all of this, like, dash, you know, indiscriminate dash nonsense. And so I got
But what's cool is that we're gearing up to possibly write a script together this summer. And at this point, we've gotten the style of writing down. So, you know, I'm psyched to get in there after we've done two scripts and then visualize both those scripts. So we know, like a lot of things that I thought would work in the East didn't turn out to work. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, a lot of things that we thought would work because they'd worked in Sound of My Voice did work again. So it's just cool to come at it for the third time.
Yeah, and to also realize how long this process is. Like, it takes just writing it, raising money, realizing it, then the commitment to promote it, which is as intense as the trying to find money. I mean, it's a nonstop. I mean, that's a 5-year span. That's if you're making a movie quickly, you know? And so it better be an idea that can sustain you for that period of time, which is good news because then hopefully you're not putting, like, you know, just crappy superficial ideas out into the world. Hopefully, like, you've found something that actually has something to say. So,
well, it's always interesting, the idea of the challenges being the thing that makes something better versus having the road cleared out by Searchlight, for instance, and saying, you know, okay, here's your money, and you don't have to suffer through that 6 months of begging, you know, everybody you know for a few dollars, and whether that actually helps you, because then you have all those bad notes that end up leading to a good note.
Right,
you know, one good note out of 300 is still
a good note. It's still a great note,
yeah.
No, we had a really great collaboration with Searchlight in that way, like Claudia and David and everybody we worked with.
Yeah, totally.
The script like became stronger, and a lot of the things that like we felt we understood were not coming out on the page and needed to be clearer. And that's a good part of the process that sharpens the arrow for shooting people.
Yeah, I've had fun within the system so far. I mean, we haven't released this movie yet, so let's get that far first and see if it's. But it's been
part of your arsenal? Do you feel like that's a big part of your thinking, is not just, you know, okay, I delivered the movie and now I'm done, and obviously you have to do press and whatever, but you've done your job, or are you really thinking about the marketing and the how they're handling all this and how it does at the box office? And
yeah, I mean, I was reading about Alexander Wang, the fashion designer who's part of the new wave of fashion designers. You were talking about the new wave of filmmakers, and he was saying that, you know, today the fashion designer can't just be involved in just designing the clothes. They have to be involved in designing the stores. How are they going to be released? I mean, every element of it, because we live in this sort of DIY time in which you have to wear a lot of hats. Mm-hmm. And it was cool to look at it from that job, because that's very different from our job, but also it's kind of similar. And then think about it for filmmaking. It's true. I mean, I think that you have to, if you're making ultra low budget movies, they can't be released in the same style that normal budget movies are released, because expectations are different. Everything's different. I mean, you know.
Unless you kill Brit repeatedly, in which case you'd be a Paramount Vantage or an InSurge or whatever.
Oh, yeah.
Or in Pelly route.
Yeah, that's like the other, Elizabeth Olsen also had two movies at Sundance, and the other one was called
Silent House.
And I was looking at the numbers for Silent House the other day, and it did really well. And it's so funny to me that you heard much less about Silent House than Martha Marcy, but which one actually did better at the box office? It, you know, it's interesting that those, you're right, that those movies actually make a lot of money.
Well, Paramount certainly magically has figured out how to sell that, you know, extremely low budget movie that aren't very good, actually. I mean, Silent House was actually pretty good, considering, compared to some of the stuff.
Is Paranormal Activity not very good?
I actually have not watched any of the Paranormal Activities, I have to admit, but I, you know, nobody seems to be particularly enthused about the quality of filmmaking. There is that thrill factor, though, that you see it and you get surprised and you get scared, much like Blair Witch, you know, there's something exciting. But they sold that with, you know, a $20 million. They pretended it was all internet love, but it was really a big $20-something million dollar ad campaign.
Oh, was it really?
Oh, yeah. And they had the theaters booked, thousands of theaters booked ahead
of
time.
That's the thing that's amazing about it, is that it's really hard, actually, to cheat the system. You can't, it's hard to, you know, like, you do still need a $20 million ad campaign to bring a movie into the world. And, like, whether that's obvious or not obvious, like, that's what's happening. And the question is, when does that model finally get broken? So that, like, if micro-budget movies are now having the level of storytelling and, like, filmmaking in them that they can compete on a larger level, how do you actually get those movies to enter the world without spending $20 million? Like, we don't know how to do that yet. It's like right now they're having these theatrical releases, but really everybody's watching them, you know, on their iPads or like on planes. You know, so how do you validate a movie in order to get
No, she's absolutely right. It's true. It's like people, we haven't figured that part of it out yet because people aren't actually going to see those movies in theaters. And so, because there isn't just the ad dollar, like people don't know about Sound of My Voice. Most people have not even heard about Sound of My Voice in the film community, maybe, but not outside of that, I don't think. And so the question is just like, without $20 million, how do you, of ad campaigns, how do people find out about it?
Well, I think the question, a lot of it is your expectations. Like when you make a movie like Sound of Your Voice, Sound of My Voice. I keep on getting the preposition wrong. But is it, when you make a movie like that, the expectation of how many people are going to see it, how many millions of people may see it in a theater or see it on VOD or whatever, has to be different. And I think that's what the indie business got so different for a while, where they were making $20 million and $30 million movies at indie distributors, including Searchlight still, that the expectations became that a movie could do $60, $70 million, Napoleon Dynamite or whatever.
Well, certainly at FSU, which is Fox Searchlight University, which is what we call it, yeah, that's the model. You know, Black Swan cost, what, $15 million and made $300 million worldwide? I mean...
But they signed on late. That's one of those weird things where they kind of signed on late, and you had Darren, you had Natalie.
Of course,
And they spent the money to release the movie. They did spend that $20 million plus to release that movie and did great with it. But that's a different thing than a movie that costs, you know, $2 million from a filmmaker who's coming to Sundance for the first time and that, you know, they're kind of bringing the movie along.
Our movie costs a lot less than $2 million.
Yeah.
But yeah.
And I don't think there's anything wrong with it. I think that's the hard part, is that so many young filmmakers are frustrated by not doing $20 million with an independent film. But that's not necessarily what your audience is if you're making the film.
That's true. But I guess I was just bringing up the point of like, oh, does Paranormal Activity actually have a much bigger audience than Sound of My Voice? Or is that just a decision to put the ad dollars behind something? I mean, it's just a good... No one will really know the answer to that question.
Well, part of the answer is a lot more people like McDonald's than like, you know, that are anxious to go out and pay $8 for a burger, you know, for a good burger. they're fine with McDonald's, and in some ways that's the McDonald's method is.
That's, you know, I wonder about that though, because if the price of the burgers was the same, like wouldn't everybody...
Movies
are the same price.
Right.
Wouldn't everybody want the umami burger? Like you're still paying $14 at Arclay. The question is just what are you seeing? And sometimes I think we really underestimate how much the audience wants substantive storytelling. And I think TV is starting to prove that. Like, my parents are watching Homeland.
Mm-hmm. My parents love it, too.
His parents are watching it, too. I'm watching Homeland. My sister's watching. Everybody's watching Homeland. And these are people who, you know, this is like a very different group of people, different generations. And they're all interested in this story that's complicated and saying, you know, interesting things. And I think people are actually really hungry for substance. It's just that we keep thinking that they, you know, I think we're underestimating the audience.
I don't think you're wrong about that, but I also, like, you know, people talk about from the amount of talk in the media about Mad Men, for instance, you thought that was the biggest show in television.
And not that many people.
It's one third of the size of The Walking Dead, and somehow The Walking Dead's having its budget cut because, you know, even though they have 9 million people watching that show every week, and only 2.5 to 3 million are watching Mad Men, but Mad Men is what the media loves.
That's
what you get.
Right, well, that's what I think Sound of My Voice is an interesting example, because it's a hybrid film. I mean, I think Sound of My Voice actually is kind of thrilling and has twists and turns and has a lot of elements from McDonald's in it, you know?
Yeah.
So.
I love this metaphor you've come with, the McDonald's versus umami burger thing, because it's true. Sound of My Voice has got a lot of McDonald's in it for all of its umami burger-ness.
Well, after Another Earth, I didn't know what to expect, obviously, going into this movie. I hadn't seen the movie at Sundance. And when I saw it, I was like, that's a much more traditional movie in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
But
and yet it's still really super weird. I mean, it's a weird-ass movie.
I don't know if it's that weird-ass. Do you think it's really weird-ass?
Yeah, I mean, like, there's narration for the backstories that happens in the movie. You never hear that
there's
narration again.
Breaks.
There are chapter breaks. There's an 11-minute scene with apples in a basement. You know, like, these are
But you're right, because...
Well, it's a challenging piece of filmmaking, but it's not... weird. You don't sit there because you're not like trying to figure out what the hell you're trying to say.
That's
clear what you're trying to say.
That's true. The film, the mathematical part of it is it's like a math proof. Like we spend a lot of time figuring out the script so that it's, you know, so that you're going along for a thrill ride. I mean, that was very important to us, that you have a thrilling, satisfying experience of the film. I mean, some people find the ending open-ended, but I don't think it's a vague ending. Like I think it's very clear what happens, what your interpretation of what that is. You know, maybe borrows a little bit from the art house. But otherwise, I think that it has, you know, a twist.
Which reminds us yet again that you guys are all individuals and not a movement. Because it's hard to forget. Sometimes it's like everything gets punched into mumblecore or into indie or Sundance or whatever that, you know, boxes, since we all like to put everybody in a box all the time.
Yeah.
And this is not, it reminds us again that you guys are, even in your little cult.
Outside of the box.
But what's fun about it is that we're like sort of a class of filmmakers, all of us, right? And we're individuals, and yet we're part of this one movement, and then we're all part of these separate groups that are giving each other support, whether it's the Duplass family. I mean, theirs is an actual family, which is awesome.
Yeah.
And the question is just what stories will we all tell, and how will those stories then meet up with their audience? Because I think less important than whether people like McDonald's or Umami Burger or whether you spend a lot of money in the marketing or not, it's a question of when does an audience really come around a film and champion it? When does that happen so that the magic of the storytelling meets with the magic of the time period that's happening and a story actually means something for the time period it's done? I mean, you know, that's really exciting, and I don't know who of all those people will actually have that moment where it clicks and there's like a movie that defines the time we're in.